Welcome to withabessa.com. I hope by now you have successfully completed first chapter, Introduction to Accounting. If you haven't been able to do so, please I would urge to go back and take a look at the videos of chapter 1 and then come back here to learn chapter 2, Theory Base of Accounting. In this, for the sake of convenience, chapter 2 we have divided into 4 units. In the first unit or in the first video, we will be discussing about accounting principles such as accounting entity, money measurement, going concern, account period, consistency, cost concept and dual aspect principles. And in the second video, we will discuss remaining accounting principles, revenue recognition, matching concept, full disclosure, conservatism, materiality and objectivity. Post that, we will discuss basis of accounting. What are the basis of accounting? We will discuss that. And then finally, in the fourth video, we will discuss accounting standards and IFRS. Fundamental question here is, why theory base? Why there is a need of some base or a fundamentals for preparing accounting statements? We know that accounting information will not be used only by owner of the business. This we discussed in first chapter, because it will be used by various other parties such as investors, bankers, government officers, etc. Not only this complexity, and the other part is, business is not restricted to only one country. If the business is in India, they may take a loan from other countries, or they may have a branch in other countries and they need to report in that country. So there should be some standard principles or a standard base or some fundamentals. Based on that, the accounting records should be prepared, and whoever sees it, he will assume that all these fundamental bases or principles are adopted while preparing financial statements. So then it will be easy for them to read. Otherwise, whenever they get a balance sheet or a P&L, they have to go through various terms and conditions to read that particular statement. On what basis they have prepared, what assumptions they have made and all these things. Instead, if they follow a standard accepted principles, then there will not be a case where we need to go through a special terms and condition with respect to a financial statements. Few people call it these things as an a principles, few people call it as an assumptions, few people call it as a fundamentals of accounting. Like this, different words, but let us assume that, or let us continue our discussion that, or each of these things as an accounting concepts. Accounting concepts or principles of accounting. Here is the first principle of accounting, or a first concept of accounting. This is called as accounting entity concept or business entity concept. Also, it is known as separate entity concept. Remember, accounting entity concept, business entity concept or separate entity concept, all three are same. This concept assumes that business entity is a separate from its owner. It's a fundamental principle of accounting or a concept of accounting, which clearly says that owner is different from the business. Once owner invests the amount into a business, that will be called as a capital. And whatever his personal expenses, he should be away from the business. He should not do any personal expenses from business amount. So business is a separate entity and owner is a separate entity, and only business related expenses should be shown in the books of accounts. Only business related expenses should be shown in the books of account. If anything is withdrawn for the personal use, that will be considered as drawings. Again and again I am repeating, drawing is a very important term. If any employee or if any owner withdraws money from the business for a personal use, it will be called as drawings. So according to accounting entity concept, only business related expenses should be shown in the accounting transactions. Let's see few examples. Example number one, Mr. X invested ₹25,000 to start a business. Is this business transaction or personal expenses? It is the business transaction. As money is getting into a business, and it will be considered as capital of the business in the books of Mr. X company. So this will be shown as a liability, or it is a capital for the business. Next, sir, example 2. Mr. X withdraws ₹10,000 from the business to pay school fees of his son. Do you need this transaction as a business transaction and record in a books of account? Yes. Though he is incurring personal expenses, he has withdrawn money from the business. So it will be considered as withdrawal money from a business. So it will be considered as business expenses, and it will be recorded as a drawings. How do we record drawings is, we take a capital, whatever they have invested. Here in the previous example, he has invested 25 capital, 25,000. Out of that, 10,000 he has withdrawn. So from the capital amount, we deduct drawings 10,000 and remaining capital is 15,000. That is how we record drawings in books of account. So any withdrawal for the personal use is business transaction. Any withdrawal from business for personal use is business transaction. Take a third example. Mr. X bought car from his savings and using it to come to office daily. Can we show car as an asset in office books? Answer is no, because he has brought a car in his name but from his own savings. So car has not brought it in the name of the business. It is in his personal expenses and it is done using the personal savings. So car cannot be shown in the books of account as an asset. If at all he has brought the car from the office expenses, otherwise he has taken a loan from his own and then he has brought a car in an office name, then we could have shown it as an asset. But now, because it is a personal savings and using it for personal purposes, it will be treated as non-business transaction. Okay. Next concept is money measurement concept. According to this concept, we need to record only those transactions which can be expressed in terms of money. Very simple. Any transaction which can be expressed in terms of money, that should be recorded in books of account. If anything we are not able to express in terms of money, then it should not be recorded. Okay. And what is examples of money measurement concept is like purchase of a goods, sale of a goods, when we pay some expenses, when we receive some income, all those transactions should be recorded. The other important aspect of money measurement concept is only all the transactions we need to maintain in monetary units but not in physical units. The two aspects within money measurement concept, one is we must record all the transaction which can be expressed in terms of money. And the second aspect of money measurement is we have to maintain all the transactions in monetary unit. For example, in India, we will be maintaining all the transactions in rupees. And in US, all the transactions will be maintained in dollars. But not in physical unit. Maintaining physical unit, what is the number of quantity we purchase, that need not to be maintained in accounts. For additional information purpose, we can write it, but from a core accounting perspective, all the transactions should be maintained in monetary units. Examples of money measurement concept: sale of goods, purchase of goods, payment of expenses, receipts of cash, etc. are the examples for money measurement concept. There is some limitations on money measurement concept. So money measurement concept will not consider change in the value of money due to a time change or usage of a material, etc. For example, if anybody buys machinery 2 lakhs around 3 years back, Again, like in the current, like it is machinery is purchased around 3 years back. When we show in the current year balance sheet, we show book value of the asset as 2 lakhs and we deduct depreciation from that. So 3 years depreciation may be around 60,000. So we show in the balance sheet like 1,40,000. But actual value of the money, actual value of the asset may not be equivalent to 1,40,000. Because people may not buy that machine if we sell it outside for 1,40,000, because that machine may be outdated or it may require a huge repair and etc. So, but whatever, as per money measurement concept, whatever the amount we incurred, that we have to show in the books of account. So we will be showing a 2 lakh rupees every year on year minus depreciation. Going concern. Going concern concept states that accounting records will be prepared with the assumption that business will run for the indefinite future period, especially show the assets in balance sheet. This is very important. Whenever we do some business, we will not do a business stating that we will close it in next 6 months. If any business we are doing for the next 6 months, then all the amount incurred in the business will be treated as expenses. But because of the going concern assumption or a going concern concept, whatever expenses, wherever we do expenditure, if the life of that expenditure is more than 1 year, then we treat that as an asset because of going concern. We assume that any business which starts, they will run for year after year. Otherwise, all the expenditures should be treated as expenses and book it and find the profit in the same period itself. So going concern concept there says that accounting the business will run for indefinite future period. So this is useful to show assets in the balance sheet. If going concern principle is adopted, only certain percentage of asset will be shown as an expenses in the balance sheet, in the current period, and remaining will be shown in asset as a balance sheet. How? I will explain it. If we purchase any asset of 20 lakh rupees today, and if we assume that the life of the asset is for 10 years. So then what we do is we put a 20 lakh as an asset value. And out of that, 10% we will take it back as an expenditure for the current period. And remaining 90% we will show it as an asset in a balance sheet. 20 lakhs minus 10% depreciation, because we consider the life of the asset is 10 years. If we use a straight line depreciation, so it is 10% we are charging directly. So it will be a 2 lakh. And asset value in balance sheet will be 18 lakhs. So the going concern concept helps us in showing assets properly in balance sheet. The next concept is accounting period. Accounting period refers that there should be some stipulated time for which we are preparing financial statement. Generally, it is 1 year. So we start with, in India, we are starting that from April of every month and we are ending it on March of the every year. The same way in few countries, people start their accounting records from January and end it in December. And in few countries, it will be from July to June. Normally, it will be for a period of 1 year. Every time people would like to know what is the profit for 1 year. In India, remember that in India, financial year starts from 1st April and ends on 31st March of next year. Okay, after that, it is very difficult, right? We do the transaction for 364 days and on the 365th day, accounting team will sit and prepare a financial statement. To avoid that, further that 1 year period will be broken down into smaller pieces. That may be a monthly or a weekly. Generally, it will be a monthly. Every month end, they will prepare a P&L and balance sheets and to verify it. So it simplifies the year-end closing process. Take an example here. April to March is a period, financial year, if we are taking an example of financial year 2016 and 17, it starts from 1st April 2016 and ends on 31st March 2017. Further, that will be broken down into a month, April 2016, May 2016, June 2016 till March 2017. And it is necessary that we should have a consistent accounting period year on year. This year we are doing it April to March, and next year we are moving to Jan to December. It is a complex process for switching over, and even if you switch, it will be difficult for comparing the data of the previous year with the current one. Generally, this period definition will be directed or governed by legislation of the country. In India, it is said that April to March as a accounting period or a financial period, so that's why people uses April to March as a financial period. Here are some questions. A concept that a business enterprise will not be sold or liquidated in the near future is known as, we said, in going concern. Business will, like, it is assumed that business will continue for a longer period and we show asset balances because of that. So answer is going concern. Business entity concept is applicable to which of the following types of businesses? Sole proprietor, partnership, or companies? Any form of business, the business entity concept is applicable. Whether it is a sole proprietor who is an individual business owner, partnership where two or more person joins together to run the business, or companies where people invest in the form of share and registered in Companies Act, all these, any form of business, we should have business entity concept should be applied. Business is different, owners are different. If owners allocates his personal expenses in books of accounts, this violates which fundamental concepts of accounting? It is business entity concept. Business entity concepts clearly says personal expenses should be kept separate and business expenses should be kept separate. Lifespan of the business is divided for the purpose of reporting company's financial position. It is based on which accounting concept? This is based on accounting period concept. Okay, next accounting concept, consistency. This we've discussed while discussing a characteristics of accounting information. Consistency clearly says that whatever the rules, regulations we are applying in a company, it should be keep on using the same principles year on year. Changing any method between the years will make data as uncomparable. So if you are using a depreciation rate of 10% straight line method, use the same thing for the next few years, so don't change in between. Otherwise, if you are not maintaining a consistency, the comparability feature of the data will be lost. We are giving a small examples here, but in real practical scenarios, you will be seeing a more complex example for all these items. So next concept is a cost concept. According to this concept, while recording the asset in the books of account, we need to include not only purchase price, also the cost of acquisition. Cost of acquisition means the amount, additional amount incurred to make this particular asset to use. For example, we will be incurring transportation expenses like moving machinery from supplier location to the plant location. Then installation, somebody has to come and install the machinery, and then there is some other expenses. All these should be included in the cost of the asset. Okay, the first aspect is while recording the asset, we must record all the expenses which are incurred to make that asset ready to use. And the second aspect of the cost concept is, the cost concept is historical in nature. As we already discussed, whatever the expenses incurred at the time of buying the goods, that only will be recorded and that will be shown year after year. There will not be any change in the cost of the asset or asset value in the books of account year after year. For example, if you purchase a laptop on 1st January 2014 and we will show the same value, like whatever the value of the 2014 in the books of account year after year, and out of that we will be deducting only depreciation. See, two important aspects here is a replaceable value or a realization value. When we purchase any asset, take example a laptop, after 3 years, if we want to replace that laptop, what is the price we are, extra amount we have to make a payment, that we will not consider while making presentation of a fixed asset. And at the same time, realization value, if laptop which is purchased for a 50,000, after 3 years, its value may not be same, because when you try to sell, realizable value means when you try to sell, what is the amount you are going to get? The 3 year old laptop in a market which was costing 50,000 in 2014, which may fetch you only 10,000 or 5,000 rupees in a market. But in the books of account, still we will show that the cost of the book value of the asset is 50,000 and less depreciation for the next last 3 years. So that means that we will be showing the values in historical values. So that's why the two aspects of cost management is cost concept are, one is it includes all the costs other than purchase price, all the costs including purchase price and the transportation, installation and other expenses which incurred for asset to make ready to use. And the second one is all the cost will be in historical in nature. Next concept is dual aspect concept. According to this concept, all the business transactions recorded in the accounting books will have two aspects. One is receiving benefit and the second one is giving benefit. Remember, we said that the first book on accounting was written by Luca Pacioli. In the book, the chapter was titled as Double Entry Bookkeeping. The title itself says that for any single business transaction, we will be recording double entry in the books of account. Means for any transaction, if there is a one business transaction, we will record two lines in business books or accounting books. So this is a fundamental principle for double entry system of bookkeeping. If we are not recording two transactions or two aspects of one business transaction, then the accounting record will be considered as incomplete. Let's see an example here. Mr. X purchased machinery from Mr. Y for rupees 50,000 on credit. Very simple business transaction. X is having a business, he has purchased machinery of rupees 50,000 from Mr. Y on credit. What is received here? Received is machinery. That is a receiving benefit. And how much amount we have to pay to Mr. Y? How much amount Mr. X has to pay to Mr. Y? That is 50,000. So the receiving benefit is 50,000 of machinery and giving benefit is amount payable to Mr. Y rupees 50,000. So for every business transaction, there will be two aspects to it. This we will discuss more in detail during our journal entry chapter. Few questions again. The dash concept requires that same accounting method should be used from one accounting period to next period. This is consistency. So question 2, everything a firm owns, it also owes out to somebody. This coincidence is explained by the dash concept. It is dual aspect concept. As question clearly says, there is always, we said, one arm the receiving benefit and there is another arm, there is a giving benefit. When we purchase a material, we receive. See, we are going to own that machine, but at the same time we will be paying money to someone. who is supplied the machine. So wherever, whatever we do in a business, there will be two aspects to it. That's why it is called dual aspects concept. Thank you. Your feedback is valuable to us. Please share your feedback on contact@vidyabhyasa.com.